Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wrong Patient by Rachel Hargrove. Narrated by Amanda Stribling. Prologue. 1 year anniversary of celebrity dermatologist disappearance by Lucy Dawson, senior health and beauty correspondent. It's been exactly 1 year since Dr. Selene Marks, the famed celebrity cosmetic dermatologist, disappeared without a trace. The doctor, widely regarded as one of the best in the industry, was last seen near a food truck on Valley Boulevard. Marks, known for her elite clientele, was dubbed the miracle worker of Beverly Hills by her adoring patients. Her innovative approach to beauty and unparalleled talent for changing lives, not just faces, set her apart in an industry often criticized for its superficiality. Her work was more than skin deep. She gave people confidence, a new lease on life, said a former patient who wished to remain anonymous. Despite the high-profile nature of her patients and her celebrity status, Marks was a deeply private individual, making the mystery surrounding her disappearance all the more puzzling. In the months following her disappearance, numerous rumors have surfaced, everything from a kidnapping to a planned escape to an undisclosed foreign country. However, the Los Angeles County Police Department remains tight-lipped about the investigation, stating only that it is an ongoing case. The world of cosmetic dermatology keenly feels the absence of Dr. Marks. Her clinic is closed, the once bustling epicenter of beauty now reduced to a silent testament of a missing woman who was at the height of her profession. The void she left is palpable, but the question persists. Where is Dr. Selene Marks? 1. Ava. They'll kill me if I don't leave. Everyone knows my address, and those who don't can find it with a simple Google search. It's not safe here, not anymore. Heart pounding, I open my phone and swipe through screens. I click on the link to a true crime forum. My name is splashed everywhere in damning headlines. Is there any chance Ava is innocent? Examining whether Ava had an accomplice. Why do you think Ava hasn't admitted to the murder? The real reason Dr. Selene disappeared. The only thing more thrilling than a missing person case is the internet's delight in blaming someone for her disappearance. But blame leads to anger, and anger to hatred. And hatred, a new post pops up. How long do we have to wait until Ava gets what's coming to her? Dad's house might be secure enough if he lets me in. I'm not above begging him. We're not on good terms, but at least he doesn't want me dead. I'll stay there temporarily, tell my family and friends I'm going on vacation and everything will return to normal. Except it won't. He'll find me. He always knows where I am. And the instant I move, he'll dox me on the damned forum, and the rest of the world will foam at the mouth until they've tracked me down. Where can I hide from the internet? I reach for a stack of clothing, pausing. Due to a court order, I can't leave California. My gaze falls to the phone again. Just like the infatuated public, I can't stop obsessing about the case. I select the post with a video of me embedded in it. A familiar intro tune of a beauty podcast fills my bedroom. Welcome back, Claire, the bubbly host, talks into a headset. Our topic today is a controversial procedure called a phenol peel. It is the most powerful chemical peel available and can produce some amazing results, but it also has one of the highest complication rates. We'll go into detail in just a second. First, I'd like to introduce our special guest, Ava Green, who's about to embark on a life-changing journey. The camera flicks to me, sitting on a stool in Claire's studio. My heavy makeup almost covers my acne scars. I used to run my fingers over my skin in front of the mirror, griping at every minor flaw that paled compared to what I have now. Hello, Claire. Thanks for having me. You know, I've never heard of this procedure until a video came across my feed. The before and after results are astounding. I'm so excited to talk about this. So your peel is on Monday? I smile. That's right. Are you nervous? I had some reservations, but I feel like I'm in good hands. I understand there's a long downtime. Can you go into more detail? she asks. Yes, there is. Because of that, Dr. Selene doesn't book the procedure without showing patients all stages of the peel. The pictures are pretty nasty. It takes 2 weeks for the scabs to fall off. After that, your face is still swollen and bright red. It stays that color for another 6 weeks, sometimes longer.
Wow!
Most dermatologists refuse to do phenol peels. There are a lot of risks.
But the potential rewards are huge.
Exactly. No procedure gives results as dramatic as the phenol peel. I've tried everything to improve the appearance of my acne scars. They make me so self-conscious. I work in real estate, so looking your best is essential when you're trying to sell a house. Claire nods.
Makes sense. Can you tell us more about the procedure?
It's a chemical peel, which is a treatment that uses an acid solution to remove damaged outer layers of skin. I say, hands folded on my lap. The phenol peel is the strongest of these, and it can help with deeper scars and wrinkles.
Why did you choose Dr. Selene Marks?
She asks. I've been visiting her clinic for a while. I'm a Dr. Selene stan. In the cold light of retrospect, my answer, meant to show admiration, now sounds fanatical. She's an artist. She can transform you.
That's a powerful word.
Well, Dr. Selene doesn't just perform procedures. She looks at you and sees what you could be. She helps bring out the person you feel like on the inside. The me on the screen hesitates, inhaling deeply. It's hard to be confident when I'm preoccupied with how I look. It affects my business. Succeeding in my career is important to me.
That's a beautiful perspective, Claire muses. And you've chosen to share this with our audience. Why is that?
To help others who feel the same way. I want them to know what a phenol peel is like, step by step, so they can make an informed decision. I tune out the rest of my speech. Claire thanks me for sharing, and the podcast ends with a promise to keep the listeners updated. A year later, Dr. Selene Marks is missing, and my transformation has taken a terrifying turn. I have changed, but not in the way I intended. It hasn't been easy to come to grips with my new face. The plastic surgeon did his best with the skin grafts, but I am still monstrous. A stabbing pain buries in my chest. The comments underneath the video eviscerate me in a flurry of assumptions. They bring up my criminal record, that I was the last person to see Dr. Selene before she went missing, and my suspicious behavior following the botched procedure. Truth Seeker 101. Incredible, right? This woman is way too fixated on Dr. Marks for comfort. Upvotes 35. Justice for Marks. She snapped when her magical transformation didn't happen. Upvotes 21. Truth Seeker 101. She got upset, maybe enough to make someone vanish. Upvotes 8. Anonymous 345. What's her motive, though? Upvotes 3. Truth Seeker 101. Desperation? Revenge? So many angles to consider. The whole scenario is wild. All of this seems like a classic case of expectations not meeting reality, then lashing out. Upvotes 10. Anonymous 345. Dumb bitch did it to herself. Upvotes 3. I exit the forum, seething. They're taking my story, twisting my intentions. I'm not just a woman recovering from a botched procedure. I'm responsible for the disappearance of a beloved mother and doctor. Someone knocks. I jump, my legs tensing.
Who is it? Ronnie.
My assistant's southern drawl filters through the door. I get up from my couch, parting the sheer curtains away from the window. Normally, I'm not so jumpy, but today was rough. She raps on the door.
Ava, open up. I have your meatball sub. Thank you. Can you leave the bag on the floor?
Why?
She asks. Ronnie's harmless, a sweet, pint-sized brunette from Texas. She's been handling most of my real estate business since I've been keeping a low profile. She often invites me over to play cards.
I love her, but if I open the door, she'll guilt me until I let her inside. If I do that, my palms will sweat. My stomach will churn. I'll obsess over what she's thinking.
I can't. I'm in my pajamas.
You think I care? Lord, I'm in PJs half the time. I grimace. I'm not in the mood.
But it's just me.
I know, but I can't. She tuts.
Eventually, you're gonna have to move on.
How can I? Staring into the mirror inflicts me with pain. My image is a daily reminder of how much I've lost. My confidence, my career, my identity. My fingers trail along the doorknob, but I can't bring myself to turn it. I'm in no mood for company. I shake my head.
Sorry.
Sweetie, this isn't healthy. You haven't left the house in 2 weeks. I peer at the bright walkway. Pain squeezes deep inside me. I haven't sunbathed in a year. I can't lie in the sun. It's bad for my skin grafts.
I have,
I protest, pressing my palm flat against the weather door.
This is just a bad day.
You have to stop reading that garbage online. You can't hide every time someone says something you don't like. I'm only hiding from the people who think I'm a monster.
You're not a monster.
That's what they say about me, I mutter, trying not to sound desperate. The people on that website, they believe I'm a murderer.
You didn't kill her. You know that.
Do I? That hangs in the air, casting a cold shadow over Ronnie's reassurances. The gaslighting from strangers for months has me questioning everything.
Course you do,
she barks, sounding agitated.
You can't keep reading that hogwash.
So many of them are convinced I did it.
I keep telling you to stay off the internet. It's nothing but a bunch of shaved kittens fixing to pluck some whiskers. Anybody who's laid eyes on you knows darn well you're not mixed up in this mess.
I haven't been myself. I've done things I'm not proud of, I think. The last year is a bit of a blur. Is it possible I did something awful and don't remember?
Police would have hauled you off to jail a long time ago.
That just means they don't have enough evidence. Truth seekers' own words haunting me. No, I can't let him in my head.
You didn't do this,
she says firmly.
I want you to say it out loud.
I fist my trembling hands. I
didn't kidnap Selene.
That's right, she booms.
Say it again, louder.
I didn't kidnap Selene. Good. When you doubt yourself, repeat that.
Over and over, you hear?
You can't let them get to you. The internet isn't the judge and jury. It doesn't need to be when it can be the executioner. She's silent for a moment.
Are you sure you don't want me to come in?
We could play cards, maybe take your mind off things. My throat tightens. No, I'm okay. I need to be alone. Thank you, though.
Well, all right then.
She sighs, and then a bag hits the floor.
I'll leave you be. The truth will come out soon. You'll see.
I hope so. I really do.
See you later.
Ronnie moves away. I wait until her footsteps disappear, then unlatch the door. I stick my arm out and grab the bag. Then I move to the coffee table, unwrapping the sub. The comforting scent of marinara sauce fills the room. I take a bite, savoring the taste. The outside world is still scary, but in my sanctuary, I'm safe. I eat a third of the sub, then force myself to put it in the fridge. As I'm washing my hands, someone knocks. I dry myself on a kitchen towel and head toward the door.
Who is it?
Nobody answers. Keeping the chain on, I slowly crack open the door. Whoever it was, they've already gone. Package delivery? I remove the chain and widen the door. I step forward, my foot landing on the doormat. I glance at the dark shape and gasp. A plastic doll lies next to the mat. It's warped and black, as though a torch burned off its face. I stumble back, an icy knot forming at my stomach. I slam the door, leaning against it. My eyes burn, but I blink away the tears. I won't let them win. I dial my sister. The line rings twice before clicking to voicemail.
It's me. I need your help. Please call me.
Then I hang up, sinking to the floor. My sanctuary feels a lot less safe. A cold thrill touches my spine as I pick up the folded piece of paper that was underneath the doll. A brief message is scrawled in thick strokes. You're next. 2. Ava. Police officers in starched blue uniforms stand in my living room like ill-placed furniture. Their careful glances take in my face, the hastily thrown-on cardigan, and my sister Brianna, tall and unruffled in her crisp suit. I'm not doing well. My skin bakes as though I'm under a heat lamp, and it's hard to speak with my stomach sucked in. The younger cop did a double take when I opened the door. He won't stop gaping at me.
So, Miss Green, when did these threats begin?
The question stabs into me. When did they start? Shortly after Dr. Selene's disappearance, officer.
Who could have a grudge against you?
A poster on a true crime community.
Have you noticed anyone suspicious lurking around your building?
No, officer. We've been on this merry-go-round more times than I can count, and my patience is gone. You have my statement, officer. I've given it to you and probably half the precinct by now. Why don't you tell me something? What are you doing about it? A heavy silence fills the room. My sister's stern expression warns me to shut up, but I'm tired of being nice. Officer Cortez cuts in.
I understand your frustration, but there is nothing we can do until he commits a crime.
Harassment isn't a crime?
What he wrote doesn't meet the legal requirement to be considered criminal harassment. He skirted the line, but it's his followers causing trouble.
And I can't point police in their direction because they delete their profiles as soon as law enforcement gets involved. I gesture at the doll.
Can you send that to the lab to check for fingerprints?
Ma'am, we have a huge backlog and melted dolls aren't a priority.
He smiles and gives me a fatherly pat on my back.
Keep documenting everything. Call us whenever this happens.
What for? I've been down this road before. When I tell a police officer about my problems, they take a report, write some notes, and file it away. Until I get hurt, they won't do a thing. The officers head to the door and Brianna shakes their hands.
Thank you for your time.
No problem.
Officer Cortez opens the door, a smile still twisting his mustache.
Take care now.
He leaves. Brianna shuts the door and locks it, triggering a memory of my teenage sister cornering me in my room. My sister is a criminal defense attorney, one of the best in the city. She has a reputation for savaging witnesses on the stand. Most crumble under her questioning, and I don't blame them. She's a tall blonde with a Rottweiler mentality. Even though I know I'm safe, it's not easy to hold her gaze, especially when she's angry and she's decided I'm on her hit list. Hands on her hips, her impatient sigh channels her father.
That could have gone better.
What'd I do wrong?
Brianna rubs her brow. For starters, you're wearing pajamas and it's after 12.
I glance down, shrugging. I could have had on a Chanel suit and they'd only look at my face.
Don't say that.
I sink into my tufted leather couch, the only relic from my old life that I haven't sold. It's the truth. People hate being around me. I make them uncomfortable. Brianna rolls her eyes but says nothing. She doesn't get it. My disfigurement is the only thing people see, but I don't argue the point. I've had many months to come to terms with my new appearance. I'm not quite there, but at least I've stopped researching ways to fix myself.
Only God makes faces, my plastic surgeon said. I can only do so much.
And he was right. Every single doctor I approached told me a similar version, expressing their deepest sympathies while urging me to see a therapist. I quit mine after she called me obsessive. If I want to be judged, I'll open up the true crime website. I need to distract myself. I pick up the remote and turn on the TV. As I try to decide between 90 Day Fiancé and Indian Matchmaker, Brianna marches to the front of the screen. "You're not out of the woods," she says. "Someone kidnapped and probably killed Dr. Selene." My throat tightens. I have my problems with Selene, but the mental image of her body in a ditch brings me no relief. Reports have maintained that she disappeared after leaving her home. Her last sighting was at a taco truck. Her purse was found weeks later, dumped in a field. It's hard to imagine the infallible Dr. Selene Marks becoming the latest statistic in a male-to-female violence. "She's fine," I mutter. "Denying what happened doesn't make you look good." "I'm not saying the situation isn't serious." Brianna's stare bores into me. "Be careful. You haven't acted like an innocent person, and that online group is poisoning public opinion." There's a hidden subtext in her words. My sister will represent me if this goes to trial. She's made it clear what I can't tell her, but her searching gaze probes me. A violent buzzing breaks the silence. Brianna's attention flicks to her phone. "Do you have any idea who that truth seeker guy might be?" I have my suspicions, but nothing concrete. "And this has been going on for months?" she asks, peering at me through a curtain of blonde hair. "Yes." "Would have been nice to find out sooner." "Yes, but my sister isn't who I go to with my problems. We've never had the best rapport. We didn't get along as kids. Our fights were vicious. Lots of hair yanking, biting, and kicking. Dad tried to stop us. Then he gave up and bought boxing gloves so no one would gouge out the other's eyeball. Until Dad got lung cancer, I didn't have much of a relationship with Brianna." She grasps my shoulder. "Next time, just call me." I wanted to handle it on my own. I thought the truth would come out and everything would blow over. "You're my sister. We're in this together." She gives my arm a comforting squeeze. "And if she's fine, we'll sue her for medical malpractice. Have you contacted any lawyers?" "I filed a suit a while ago." "You did? That's good." "My lawyer's working on it with her insurance. It'll take years to settle, so I'm not holding my breath. I've been focused on healing. It took a while to accept that I'll never look the same." "You shouldn't have done it," she says, hardening again. "I glanced at your paperwork. You agreed to this risky procedure that had a 36% risk of cardiac arrhythmia. 36? "That number is based on an old study." "Still, there has to be cardiac monitoring because that chemical you allowed them to put on your face stops hearts from beating. Why would you take that chance?" That same question loops in my brain when I look in the mirror. I shake my head. "I just wanted to be beautiful." Brianna exhales roughly. "The world doesn't judge you half as harshly as you judge yourself." "That's not true in this town." "Ava, these threats. I'm afraid for you. You should go to Dad's house." "I'd rather not." "You have to." My pulse races at the thought of showing up on his doorstep with a suitcase. "It'll be a nightmare. The last time I saw Dad was at the hospital after my skin graft surgery. He pulled up a chair and berated me." "I know Dad can be an insensitive jerk, but you don't have a lot of options." "He won't understand, just like you didn't then." Brianna checks her watch, swearing. "I have to go. I need to pick up Lily from soccer practice." I swallow hard, nodding. "Thanks for coming." "Ava, listen to me. You're in danger. Promise me you'll take this seriously." I will." Brianna leaves, her heels stubbing the carpet. As I shut the door, a sudden chill wraps my body. Somewhere out there, a faceless adversary wants to hurt me, and the police can't protect me. What if the next knock on the door isn't a cop, but him? I clutched the door handle, steeling myself for a night where every sound could signal danger. 3. Ava. Dad.
Brianna told me what happened. You should come over.
An hour after she leaves, Dad's texts ping my phone. I don't have the energy to deal with him. He'll fly into a rage about that damned doctor and launch into a speech about how my obsession ruined my life, that I should accept myself. I've heard it before and don't need another lecture. When I was 9, Dad uprooted our Midwest lives for the sun-drenched streets of LA. Since then, I've been in a relentless pursuit of perfection. When I was 11, I tried surviving on a model's diet of black coffee and a few bites of cottage cheese, which lasted until I passed out and ended up in the ER. Then I got older, and puberty became my enemy. Parts of my body swelled. Hormones made me bloat. Acne sprouted everywhere. Giant red pustules left me with pockmarked skin. Boys at school called me ugly to my face, and that shame carried to adulthood. I took acting classes, enamored with the idea that I could transform into anyone I wanted. In this city, appearances are more than superficial. They're currency, and mine always seemed to fall short. My reflection never quite matched the perfect images plastered on billboards across the city. Acting was a dream. I couldn't support myself on hope, so I turned to real estate, a world where success wasn't dictated by the symmetry of your features. But the industry here has its own rules. Every client meeting was a performance where your looks could seal the deal. The pressure to maintain a flawless facade was relentless. As I grab a container of leftovers, I glance at a note pinned to the fridge. Beauty begins the moment you decide to be yourself. Those words rang true a year ago. My days revolved around working as a real estate agent while trying to land auditions. Now, my dream is dead, and I'm piecing together who I am. My phone rings. Ronnie's name flashes on the screen. I answer. Hey. Just thought I'd check in. How are you? Not great. I put on a smile, but can't quite force out. I'm fine. I'm breaking down from the sheer amount of hatred aimed at me. But I'm not fine. I wipe my cheeks. I got another death threat. Oh, sweetheart. I'm sorry to hear that. My throat aches. Everybody thinks I killed her thanks to a man I've never met. Not every single soul. You should see how my sister looks at me. I'm so tired, Ronnie. I can't focus. The stress is killing me. Then let me help you out. I rub my temples. You're already doing enough for me. Besides, I have to get to work. I'll never leave this apartment if I don't. I'm always here. And don't you worry about your clients. I've got things covered on this end. Besides, I'm a workaholic, so don't feel bad about delegating. I just don't want to impose. You're not. Think of it as sharing the load. Her rapid typing clicks through the speaker. Mr. Watt reached out. He's very understanding and hopes you're doing all right. Said he's okay with me handling his listing. I didn't realize he was planning to sell. Yeah, he's looking to move closer to his daughter. New grandkid on the way, she adds. I smile. Good for him. We ought to touch base on the Black property. I grimace, thinking of the listing I eagerly took on before sense kicked in. Every time I step into the Black mansion, it's like walking into a faded dream from Hollywood's golden age. The mansion's historic property status makes any significant renovation impossible. And whispers of old Black family scandals deter potential buyers. The family's high asking price doesn't help. It's a magnificent decaying cage. Beautiful, but unsellable. Harry keeps sending emails, wondering why it hadn't sold yet. The family must be hounding him for money. He wants it off his hands. So do I. The patriarch of the family, Harry Black, isn't the easiest client to deal with. I'll call him. I'm not sure what more he expects us to do.
It won't sell without a price cut. Oh, there's a new Caribbean sandwich place a few blocks from my house. Un Bien. Supposed to be amazing. How about we grab lunch this week?
A lunch date sounds nice. Almost unreal with what's been going on.
Everyone needs a break, she says gently. Give me a ring when you're ready.
Will do. Thanks for everything.
Anytime. And remember, we got each other's backs. Take care and call me if you need anything, okay?
Bye now. I hang up and grasp my laptop. Ronnie's unwavering support feels good. The knot in my throat seems to shrink, but it swells into a boulder the moment I open my email. I can't voice my clients on Ronnie forever. The fact I still have a business is a miracle, considering recent events. After answering a few emails, I brave the outdoors in a wide-brimmed hat, sunglasses, and a generous layer of sunscreen. Sunlight catches the pool behind the apartment building, making it sparkle. The idea of a swim is tempting, but it's not an option. I pick a chaise under an umbrella and sit down. There's a diverse crowd out today. Some people are curvy, others petite, barely skimming 5 feet. Every dimple and crease is on display. If only I'd loved my body like them. Humming draws my attention to the chaise beside mine. An older woman lounges in a one-piece, her silver hair tied into a loose bun. She's reading a book. My gaze falls on the title and my heart skips. Embracing My Reflection, The Journey from Imperfection to Self-Acceptance by Dr. Selene Marks. I lean over.
Is that any good?
She looks up.
It's wonderful. Dr. Selene is a visionary. She's such a fascinating woman.
Yeah, she had a rough life.
Access Hollywood did a story about her. I bought her book when I heard she was missing.
I've been meaning to read it. She closes the book and offers it to me.
Why don't you take it? I've already read it twice.
Oh, I couldn't.
Don't worry about it.
She hands me the book, grinning as though she's given me a great treat.
Everyone should read this at least once.
I have, but I nod and smile. Thank you. Her eyes twinkle.
Sometimes the universe has a way of giving us signs. Maybe this is one for you.
She gets up and walks away, a towel bundled under her arm. I stare at the cover. Despite the urge to hurl the memoir into the pool, I open it. The first few chapters recount Selene's early years, battling acne in her teens, her struggle with body image, and the mental scars left behind by an abusive mother. The book is a woman's journey to find acceptance in a judgmental world. A particular passage jumps out. A young girl came into my clinic, makeup unable to hide her red blotchy skin. She begged me to fix her. That day, I saw not only her flaws, but a reflection of my younger self. It was a reminder of my mission, to help others feel beautiful just as they are. How touching. The disparity between this self-aware Dr. Selene and the woman whose treatment wrecked my face is glaring. Was her intention to push boundaries to seek validation for herself? I stumble upon a candid snap of a younger Dr. Selene with pimply skin. Right next to it, a polished Dr. Selene. The tag reads, "Throw back to the days without filters. Scars are just life's tattoos." Damn the irony. I leave the book on the side table. Returning to my apartment, I head straight to the bathroom mirror. I remove my hat and sunglasses and examine myself. The skin grafts tell a story I wish I could rewrite. I grab my phone, checking my social media notifications. I disabled comments on my realtor page, but my inbox is flooded with hateful messages. Every notification is a punch to my gut, but amid the barrage, one name stands out. Of all my harassers, Truth Seeker has been the most persistent. I blocked him multiple times, but he always pops up with a new account. His dedication to attacking me feels so damned personal. He whipped everyone into a frenzy after Dr. Selene vanished. He called me a killer. Then another user posted my address and egged everyone on to send me death threats. A moderator deleted the post with a stern warning to the community. But clearly they have it saved because burned dolls are showing up on my doorstep. Who is he? A fan of Dr. Selene? Or someone who wants me dead? Who could that be? I flick through an album of inflammatory screenshots. My stomach turns as I click on a nauseating post. Truth Seeker 101. AG, if caught, might meet the criteria for the death penalty. Various legal minds have different opinions, but I'd like your thoughts on especially heinous and depraved crimes. Authorities could see the case differently. Despite the existence of the death penalty in California, nobody has been executed in 17 years, rarely implemented in recent years. Strict criteria define eligibility for capital punishment. Heinous acts committed during another felony typically qualify. Especially cruel actions are central to this classification. Recently, I've been thinking that she took S somewhere. Every supporter of S prays for her safe return, but fears the worst. Upvotes 54. I turn off the screen, fuming. Obsessing about Truth Seeker's identity is getting me nowhere. Only Dr. Selene can put an end to this madness. Since I can't talk to her, who can I approach? Zoe, Selene's former assistant. She stopped answering my calls around the same time as the doctor. A quick search tells me she's working at a clinic in Manhattan Beach. She was always elusive on the phone, but face-to-face, that'll be a different story. I've had enough. I don't care what it costs me. This isn't just about clearing my name anymore. It's about reclaiming my life. I'm not the villain. And it's time to prove it. 4. Selene. 18 months ago. I stroll into the Tesla store, the noise of the mall fading behind me. Floor-to-ceiling glass walls frame gleaming cars and lights illuminate the immaculate bodywork. I wasn't planning on purchasing a car. The Range Rover and BMW are more than sufficient for my needs, but the impulse to buy struck me hard as I walked past the store. A staff member's bowed head lifts, his eyes flickering over me. He stiffens into a ramrod, the look of quiet boredom replaced by a big smile. He sets down his phone and hurries to my side. "Hello, my name is Kyle." "I'm Dr. Marks." "Lovely to meet you, Dr. Marks. Can I help you with anything?" My gaze drifts over the impressive lineup. "I'm interested in one of these." He lights up. "Fantastic, I can show you the latest model."
"Sounds good."
He launches into a scripted speech and throws out a list of marketing buzzwords. Eco-friendly, full self-driving capability, 0 to 60 in 3 seconds. He prattles on about its various features. But I don't care how fast it is. I care about how I'll feel as I'm driving one. His words wash over me as I admire the car. Its flawless body is a testament to its blend of form and function. The thought of owning this elegant machine stirs something inside me. It's a reminder of how far I've come. In my 20s, I didn't have 2 nickels to rub together. Now I'm buying a luxury car on a whim.
"Will you be trading in another vehicle?"
he asks. "No." His eyes widen and he plasters on a grin. As I follow him, I notice a blue car to my left. I pause and frown, leaning in closer. "Is that a scratch?" I point at a faint line on the bodywork. Kyle stops in the middle of his sales pitch, glancing at the mark. He rubs his neck.
Well, those are our floor models. They might have a few minor blemishes, but your car will arrive from the factory in perfect condition."
Kyle continues his routine, trying to steer the conversation to the car's impressive features. But the blemish is like a record scratch on my brain. My mood plummets.
"This is the interior," he says, opening the door. "The seats are vegan leather and extremely comfortable."
I lean in, peering inside. I inhale leather.
my spirits rising until I glance at the steering wheel. A tiny smudge mars the stitching. It's not a big deal, it'll probably come off, but the sight of it turns my stomach. My enthusiasm for a Tesla vanishes. How can I buy it now? It doesn't feel good enough. Nothing ever is. That's my fault. The image I've cultivated for myself demands excellence. I study my reflection in the shiny window. Sometimes I feel like a diamond under immense pressure.
Dr. Marks?
He asks softly, as though sensing the shift in my interest.
Is everything all right?
I muster a polite smile. Thank you for your time, Kyle. I've changed my mind. He wilts.
Of course. Let me know if you need anything.
I pass by the desk, digging into my purse for a $50 bill, and slide it on the counter. He stammers a thank you as I wave him off, leaving the dealership. He's probably not used to getting tips, but I give cash to everybody. I was the girl behind the counter, living with three roommates. Even when I got my place, I lived in Starbucks, so I didn't have to turn on air conditioning. Thank God those days are far behind me. I forged my world with relentless attention to detail, but I know better. No matter how beautiful things seem, there's always a flaw waiting to be discovered. The irony isn't lost on me. Every day people come to my clinic, seeking perfection, thinking I hold a magical key. And here I am, trapped in the same quest for the unattainable. I'll visit another dealership, maybe Rivian. It'd be cute to buy two cars with matching colors, one for me and the other for my son. I head to the parking garage and grab my cell, unlocking the screen. I check my messages, but of course, nothing from him. Since I told him my honest opinion of his crazy girlfriend, he's ignored me. I scroll past unanswered text. Pain flickers through my disappointment. I shut off my phone, stowing it away. My chest burns as I stride to my car, throwing my purse in the passenger seat. Motherhood is not as magical as everyone makes it seem. My son's growing distance is yet another twist of the knife. Despite everything I've achieved, what I can't get right is connecting with my child. Did I miss baseball practices when he was little? Sure. But I made up for it by paying his college tuition and rent on his first apartment, and buying him every pet he asked for, including an African serval, which I donated to a zoo when he stopped taking care of it. I have never denied him a single thing. You'd think he'd be overflowing with gratitude, that he'd call me once in a while. By the time I reach my house in Santa Monica, the horizon burns orange. My house is a towering structure of glass and steel, its expansive windows reflecting sun rays. The manicured lawn is a testament to the gardener who keeps my property flawless. As I step through the front door, a wave of cool air welcomes me. Marble floors echo under my heels. A giant abstract painting adorns the white wall, the riot of color contrasting with the house's minimalist aesthetic. The rest of my home continues in the same modern vein, the open floor plan and glass walls providing sweeping views of the beach. My personal assistant, Zoe, inclines her head in a tight nod. She's been with me for a couple years, managing everything from my schedule to my travel arrangements. I set my keys on the console table by the entrance and shrug off my coat. Zoe, arrange an appointment at the Rivian dealership for next week. Zoe nods, typing on her phone.
You have a video conference tomorrow morning with representatives from Nulta. They have some new products they want you to consider.
I make my way toward the living room. It's perfectly arranged, not a cushion out of place. A timer beeps, and Zoe gets up. She walks to me, opening her palm to reveal two pills. I take them and the bottled water she offers, swallowing them down. Anything else? I ask her.
Yes, your last interview for the book is on Friday, and a lifestyle podcast reached out. They want to schedule something in a few weeks.
How many followers?
50,000?
I drink more water. Forget it. Not worth my time.
Doctor, I would reconsider. Their audience is very engaged on social media.
I'm not sure if I'm up for yet another Q&A on my fictional skincare regime. I had a long bedtime ritual until a woman walked into my practice. She was 76, but looked like she was in her 50s. What was her skincare regime?
Sunscreen lotion and a $15 night cream available at Walmart.
After that, I cut out most of my products and never noticed a difference. My clients never leave my practice without the bare minimum to rejuvenate their skin, but some of them get fixated on imaginary flaws. They buy every single Dr. Selene Marks branded product. I love them. They'll swear up and down that my skincare line is a game changer. I let them believe it. So many of these women have unrealistic expectations about what they can achieve. A glorified moisturizer is a small price to pay for happiness.
You have a virtual consultation in an hour,
Zoe reminds me. All right, I'm going to take a quick nap. I stand, heading upstairs. Tell them I'll think about the podcast. In the meantime, find more influential ones. We have a book to promote.
Of course, Dr. Selene.
5. Ava. I remember staring at the Hollywood sign as a kid, believing it symbolized a world where I could be anyone. Little did I know it would demand I be everything but myself. I constantly felt like an imposter in LA's unforgiving landscape of beauty, trying to sculpt a masterpiece from a lump of clay. I stand in front of flawless beauty.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.